A big part about understanding Airtable is how it works as a browser-based database. The URLs in Airtable are incredibly important. Every single base that you build, every view, everything in Airtable has a unique ID that's going to help drive that URL. If you really want to understand Airtable, you need to understand what the URL means and how to use it to your advantage. So if that's of interest, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth. I own Gap Consulting, where we help you organize and automate your business so that you can save up to 20 hours of your time every week thanks to no-code tools and automation. If that's of interest and you want to learn more, you definitely want to check out my free automation training, where I'm going to teach you the fundamentals of automation so that you can start implementing simple automations in your business today. Check that out at garethpronovost.com/webinar-registration. But without further ado, let's hop on into the heart of this video, where we're talking about Airtable URLs. Now, we have to break this into three main chunks. In Airtable, we have three major different functions. We have the data structure itself, we have any automations that we build in Airtable, and we have interfaces. And I'm excited to say that every single one of these sections or pillars of the Airtable platform has its own URLs that we need to understand. So let's start with the data structure. If we look at the URL here on my screen, I am inside a specific database called video content. And that part is actually denoted right here in my URL. The very first part of the URL in the data structure is the app. APP are the first three letters of every single one of these. And this stands for app. This is your database, your Airtable base that you're in. It has its own unique ID. And so everything else that follows this is obviously going to be assigned to this particular base. So that first chunk again, APP, and then whatever the random string is, that is your base ID. This whole string right here in between those slash marks is your base ID. Following your base ID, you're going to see the table ID. This starts with TBL, and then it has, again, a random string. Now, this ID is unique to whatever table you're in. So in my example, I'm in the content table right now of my video content database. If I flip into my posts database, this is the table that I use to schedule out my social media posts. Well, you'll notice that that table ID has changed. This one ends in KHD. If I go back to content, that table ID ends in CBJ, but of course in both cases, the app ID is the same. So whenever I switch from one table to another, the app ID, everything to the left of this is going to stay the same. Everything to the right of this is going to change. We're going to start with the table. So depending on what table we're in, that's going to drive this. Now, the next part here is the view ID. Every view obviously is assigned to a table. A view applies to a table in particular. And in this case, I'm in the content table and I have a number of different views here on the left-hand side of my screen. This part right here is the ID for the view that I'm in. It always starts with VIW for view. And then it has, again, a random string. That's the unique identifier for this particular view. Now, this is important to know because if you wanted to share with somebody a link that would take them to a specific view in your database, what you would need is everything here. Everything here, because you first start at the app level, the base level, we drill into the table, and then finally we drill into the view. Now, the last piece here, it's actually a little bit of a throwback to a legacy term. Not too long ago in Airtable, instead of calling these extensions, we called them blocks. So if you have any extensions built in your database, the last part here is simply saying, are the blocks hidden or are they shown? So if I wanted to open up an extension, I could do that by clicking here, and you see that my URL changes ?blocks=, and this is the specific view that I'm in, because inside of here we have different dashboards inside of our blocks. And so I could create a second dashboard here if I needed one, make this dashboard 2. When we see this, we see that this ID, this is our dashboard ID, ends in DDU. If I change to a different dashboard, go to dashboard 1, now we see that that ID is changed. Again, notice that we're starting at the top level, base, down to table, down to view, down to which extension dashboard are you viewing, or in the case where you don't have an extension open, then we're going to say blocks equals hide right here. So that's it for the URL inside of your data, but what happens about automations? I'm glad that automations are now following similar rules. So let's click on into our automations. Here in our automations, obviously an automation is assigned to a database, so we have to start with the base that the automation lives in. And then, since automations don't have tables or views, we can skip all of that noise. But here we go into the next identifier here. This is a unique ID for the automation that I'm looking at. If I switch to a different automation, the part here, the final part of this URL will change. Now, the beginning of this is always going to be WFL. My best guess is that that stands for workflow, since that's exactly what an automation is. And so you'll always know what this chunk is. If it starts with WFL, you're looking at an automation-specific URL. Again, starting at the base level, drilling into the specific automation or workflow in question. Now lastly, we should look at interfaces. These follow a little bit different of a rule. When we switch into interfaces, of course, I start with the app again, the base ID, and then the home page for the interfaces inside that app is just /interfaces, following the app ID. After that though, if we drill into an interface in particular, we're going to see a unique ID here. Now I'm not exactly sure what PBD stands for. If you know, please drop me a note in the comments and enlighten me. I thought page by design maybe, something about designer perhaps, not exactly sure what it is, but this ID is unique to this interface. Now we can drill into a specific page within our interface. Here I've built a simple form inside of my interface where I can create a new piece of content that I want to add to my planning. And so you'll notice that when I'm in here, I lose that PBD. Whatever that particular ID stood for, that's now gone. What I do see here is the base again, because everything is assigned to that base. And then after that, we're looking at the specific page ID for this interface. And it starts with PAG, probably for page. So if we were to build multiple interfaces, this ID here is gonna be unique for each one of the different pages inside of our different interfaces. So why does all this matter and what can you do with it? Well, by knowing what these different URLs are, you can actually direct better workflows inside of Airtable. Let's say, for example, I wanted to have a place inside of my Airtable base where I could just click a button and open up the exact page I want to look at. In this case, let's say I wanted to look at this particular interface designer. Cool. Grab that interface, go back into Airtable now, into my base. Let's go ahead and first flip into a grid view, and I can just right click here and insert a new field. I'll call this interface form, and I'll make it a button field. Let's go ahead and make it a URL. Inside of quotation marks, I just paste the URL for that particular interface designer. Create that field, and now I can just open this at any point in time. I can go back to my other views and bring that new element into my views. Let's bring it in right here. Now imagine I'm working in this base and it suddenly dawns on me, I get a new idea for a new video that I want to create. With a simple click of the mouse, I can just open up that particular interface designer without having to click through a bunch of different things. Or another example would be, let's suppose you wanted to keep excellent documentation around your automations so that if one broke or something wasn't working, you had a document to go back to and track that. Well, you definitely want to document the URL for those different automations. So imagine instead you're saying, hey, I've got 3 different automations or 8 different automations in this database, and for every single record that you create, you're documenting that automation and saving the URL for that automation so that if you ever need to troubleshoot the automation in the future, it's literally one mouse click away. Understanding these URLs, it's a really simple concept, but if you implement it into your workflow, it's gonna help you take this to the next level and just save you that much more time. I hope you got a ton of value out of this video. If you did, be sure to subscribe to this channel, give this video a like so that the YouTube gods smile on us, and I will see you in the next video.
As always, I hope you found that to be extremely helpful. If you did and you'd like to learn more, swing by our website and see how we can help. We offer a free Airtable crash course that will help you level up in Airtable quickly, and we also have some paid services, including hourly consultations with our experts. We have some online courses and a group coaching program. And for advanced needs, we can build a bespoke solution for you from scratch. So swing on by, and I look forward to connecting with you soon.